Hello viewers, so welcome to my channel. I'm Hashim Ali Khan. So this video is the continuation of the last video. The last video I have explained you about the meaning of the term ratio, ratio analysis, advantages, limitations and classification of ratios. So this is the continuation. So before what, without watching the first video, you should not watch this video. So to get the complete command, every student must learn the meaning of the term ratio, advantages, limitations, all these things are very much necessary. Directly you cannot watch the problems on ratio analysis, you cannot be able to understand. So if you have not watched the earlier first video on ratio analysis, I suggest you to go to the playlist of my channel, select the subject financial statement analysis. Select the topic ratio analysis, watch the first video, then you can continue this second video. Now in this video, I'm going to explain you about the main classification of ratios and the formulas. And this is very, very important because without understanding this, you cannot be able to solve the problems. It is not just simply to apply the formula and get the answer. You have to give the explanation also. Interpretation also you have to give. So interpretation depends on your understanding of the formulas, concept. You have to know it, then only you can be able to give the interpretation. So from that point of view, it's very, very important. First of all, functional classification. Different bases of classification of ratios are there. One of the most important method of classification of ratios is functional classification. According to functions, the ratios are classified into four categories. First, liquidity ratios. Second, leverage or solvency ratios. Third, activity or turnover ratios. And last one, fourth one, profitability ratios. In this way, according to functions, we have classified into four categories. Now, each category we have ratios. We have the formulas. So, first of all, we are taking liquidity or short-term solvency ratio. First of all, you must know what do you mean by liquidity. Liquidity means ability of the business to pay the current obligations on time. Ability of the business to meet the current obligations on time. A business organization will have so many current obligations. That means the obligations which are to be paid within a short period. Example, all the liabilities which are payable within 1 year are current liabilities. Are the liabilities which are to be paid. So, ability of the business to meet the current obligations on time is called liquidity. So every business wants to find out what is our liquidity position. Can we be able to meet all our current obligations on time or not? If the liquidity position is bad, no creditor will supply the goods, no banker will come forward to extend the loan. So business credit worthiness will come down. The liquidity position should be sufficient. So liquidity or short-term solvency, short period of time, whether the business can be able to pay it or not, that is liquidity. For calculating liquidity, four ratios you have to remember. The first ratio is current ratio. Liquidity ratio, the first ratio is current ratio. Current ratio is the ratio between current assets and current liabilities. The current assets, the relationship between current assets and current liability, the relationship will be shown by current ratio. Example, if the current ratio is 2:1, it means the current assets are double the current liabilities. Example, for 1 rupee of current liability, we have 2 rupees of current assets. That means the current liability will be paid from current assets only. So always current assets must be higher than current liabilities. That's what current ratio. Before that, you must know what do you mean by current assets. The current assets are those assets which can be converted into cash within a period of 1 year. So example of current assets are cash in hand, cash at bank, stock of goods, stock of finished goods, stock of raw materials, stock of work in progress, then debtors, receivables, then bills receivable, prepaid expenses, short term investments. So all these things, what I told, cash in hand, cash at bank, stock of goods, then debtors, that is receivables, trade receivables, then trade trade receivables, then bills receivable, prepaid expenses, short-term investments. These are the examples of current assets. Current liabilities are those liabilities which are payable within a period of 1 year. Example of current liability are creditors, sundry creditors, or trade payable, bills payable, outstanding expenses, bank overdraft, provision for taxation, proposed dividend, etc. So these are called current liability, right? So current assets by current liability will give you current ratio. The ideal current ratio, the standard current ratio is 2:1. Normally it is seen that the current assets should be double the current liability. 2:1. If 1 lakh rupees are current liabilities, then 2 lakh rupees should be current assets. If 5 lakh rupees are the current liabilities, then 10 lakh rupees should be the current assets. Double. So normally it is seen. So if a business is having less than 2:1, that means the liquidity position of the business is not sound. The business may find it difficult to pay the current liabilities. If the ratio is below 2:1. If the ratio is more than 3:1, it means that the business is having idle funds which are not properly invested. That means the profitability will come down. Idle funds will not generate any funds. Idle funds will not generate any return. The funds should not be kept idle. So keeping high current ratio is also not good. Keeping low current ratio is also not good. If we keep low current ratio below 2:1, the firm will find it difficult to pay the current liabilities on time. Liquidity position is bad. If the current ratio is more than 3:1, it means that the business is having idle funds which is not properly utilized. The profitability will come down. That's why management. The current ratio should be managed. So this is current ratio. This is the first liquidity ratio. Second, quick ratio. The quick ratio is also called acid test ratio or liquid ratio. This ratio shows the relationship between quick assets and quick liabilities. So what are quick assets? The assets which can quickly be converted into cash. Those assets which can quickly be converted into cash is called quick asset. Example of quick assets are current assets minus stock minus prepaid expenses. From current assets, deduct two assets, stock and prepaid expense. If you deduct these two assets, the remaining assets are called quick assets. And quick liabilities is equal to current liability minus bank overdraft. Current liability minus bank overdraft, you will get quick liability. But there is a controversy regarding this formula. Many authors say the bank overdraft is not a quick liability, it is a current liability. Because continuously it will be there. Bank overdraft will be there throughout the year on a long term basis. So why to treat bank overdraft as a quick liability, which we should take current liability only. So the standard formula, the formula which is used by most of the authors are quick asset by current liability instead of quick liability. Many authors say it is prudent to use current liability instead of quick liability in the denominator. So whatever treatment you make, it is better to write a note in examination. While solving the problem, if you are having a controversy whether to take quick liability or current liability, better you take given note. Better you give a note that we have treated the bank overdraft is also a current liability, so we have taken current liability in denominator. So what formula we will apply? Quick asset by current liability. Quick asset is equal to current asset minus stock minus prepaid. The standard quick ratio is 1:1. Here current ratio is 2:1. That means current assets should be double the current liability. Whereas quick asset should be at least equal to current liability. At least equal to current liability. 1:1 means if you have 1 lakh rupees current liability, you must have a minimum of 1 lakh rupees in quick asset. 1 lakh rupees in quick asset. So if your quick ratio is 1:1, it's good. No matter of any worry. If your current quick ratio is less than 1:1, that means your liquidity position is not good. If your quick ratio is more than 1:1, that means 4:1 like that, that means you are having idle fund. Your business is not using properly the funds available. So you should not keep either high quick ratio or low quick ratio. It should be maintained 1:1. This is quick ratio. Next, third liquidity ratio is absolute liquid ratio. Absolute liquid ratio. So it is a ratio of absolute liquid assets to quick liabilities. But again, for calculation purpose, we can take the denominator as current liability. So there is a controversy regarding to take quick liability. So it is always better to take current liability. So ratio will be absolute liquid assets divided by current liabilities. Now the question arises, what are absolute liquid assets? Cash in hand, cash at bank, and short term marketable security. Short term marketable investment or securities. So three items we are including: cash in hand, cash at bank, and short term investments. These three are absolute liquid assets divided by current liabilities. Next, last and final, that is liquidity ratio, is basic defensive interval ratio. This ratio will be very rarely used. Normally we'll use these three ratios: current ratio, quick ratio, and absolute liquid ratio. Current ratio, current assets by current liabilities. Then quick ratio, quick asset by current liabilities. Absolute liquid ratio, absolute liquid assets by current liabilities. Now, basic defensive interval ratio. It examines the firm's liquidity position in terms of its ability to meet its projected daily expenditure from operations. On a daily basis, can the business be able to meet all the daily obligations, daily expenditure or not? So on daily basis, whether the business is able to pay or not, the basic defensive interval ratio formula is quick assets divided by projected daily cash requirement. Quick asset divided by projected daily cash requirement. So how to calculate projected daily cash requirement? Here is the formula: projected cash operating expenses divided by number of working days in a year. So we calculate how much is the projected expenditure required, cash required for operations throughout the year, divided by number of working days in a year. This will give you cash required, projected daily cash requirement. So the higher the ratio, the better it is. So these are the four formulas I have explained you regarding liquidity ratio. In this chapter, student must remember the formula. Again, I repeat, liquidity ratios are applied to find out the ability of the business to pay the current obligations on time. Short-term solvency. For checking the short-term solvency, testing the short-term solvency, we apply liquidity. First, current ratio, current assets by current liabilities, standard current ratio 2:1. Then quick ratio, quick asset by current liability. Quick asset by current liability, the standard ratio is 1:1. Then absolute liquid ratio, absolute liquid assets divided by current liability. Then basic defensive interval ratio, quick assets divided by projected daily cash requirement. And projected daily cash requirement is equal to projected cash operating expenses. Projected cash operating expenses during the year divided by number of working days in a year. That's it. So these are the four formulas. Now I am coming to the next head, that is leverage or capital structure ratios. Long-term solvency ratio. The first one, liquidity ratio, or short-term solvency ratio. Whether the business can be able to meet the current obligations or not, short-term. Long-term, whether the business can be able to go for a long period of time or not, like 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. So some people are there who are interested in liquidity. Some people are there who are interested in long-term solvency. Simple example, the creditors, the suppliers. The supplier of goods are interested in liquidity ratio. I'm having a business. Suppose Mr. X is a supplier of material. So before supplying the material on credit, he will see my liquidity position. Can I be able to pay the liability on time or not? Short-term liquidity he will test. If my short-term liquidity position is good, the supplier will supply the goods. He is interested in liquidity. Whereas the investors or bankers, they are more interested in the long-term solvency. They are not interested in short-term solvency. The investor, before investing the money in the business, the investor wants to see whether my money is safe or not, whether the business can be able to go for a long period of time, like 5 years, 10 years or not. How much is the ratio of owner's fund and outsider's fund? In the business, how much is owner's fund and how much is outsider's fund? Suppose owner's fund is more and outsider's fund is less, then the business is good. That means business has more chances it will go. Normally, owner's fund should be more than the debt fund. If more debt is involved, then the risk of the business will increase. If the debt is more and owner's fund is less, that means the business is risky. There are chances that the business may collapse because the debt is more. So to find out the proportion of debt and equity, we apply this leverage ratio. It is also called capital structure ratio. It is also called long-term solvency ratios. Now, what are the leverage ratios? First one, it indicates the relative interest of owners and outsider in the business. How much funds are invested by owners and how much funds are invested by the outsiders in the form of debt? In the form of debt. To find out, to show the proportion, relationship, we apply leverage ratios. The first leverage ratio is debt-equity ratio. Debt-equity ratio. The formula for debt-equity ratio is long-term debts divided by shareholders' fund. Debt-equity ratio, long-term debt divided by shareholders' fund. So what do you mean by long-term debt? Debentures, bank loan, or any other long-term loan. The business has taken a loan to be repaid after a long period of time. In a long period of time. So debenture, normally it is a long-term only. Bank loan, we assume that banker has given the loan for a long period of time. So long-term debt means debentures and bank loan. What do you mean by shareholders fund? Shareholders fund means equity share capital plus preference share capital plus reserves and surplus minus fictitious assets. The fictitious assets like preliminary expenses, discount on issue of shares, discount on issue of debentures, profit and loss account, debit balance. So four examples I have given. Fictitious asset. Fictitious means imaginary. Imaginary asset. Preliminary expenses, discount on issue of shares, discount on issue of debentures, and one more item, profit and loss account, debit balance. If these items are there, they are called fictitious. That will be deducted. So what is shareholders fund? Equity share capital plus preference share capital plus reserves and surplus minus fictitious. So debt equity ratio, long-term debt divided by shareholders fund. If the debt equity ratio is more, it indicates that the business is more risky. Normally it is standard that debt equity ratio should be 2:1. That means maximum debt of a business is 2, not more than 2. If a business is having a debt ratio or debt equity ratio of 2:1 or less than 2, it is better. Suppose if a business is having a debt equity ratio of more than 2, then the business is more risky. So the outsiders who want to make the investment in the business will not be willing to invest the money in the business. Next comes proprietary ratio. The proprietary ratio shows the relationship between net worth and total assets. Net worth means shareholders' fund. What is the proportion of shareholders' fund in the total assets of the business? Suppose the total assets of the business are 10 lakh. Out of 10 lakh, 9 lakh rupees are shareholders' fund. That means proprietary ratio is 0.9. Proprietary ratio is 0.9. That means for every 1 lakh rupee of total assets, 75,000 rupees are the owner's fund, shareholder's fund. The proportion of net worth to total assets, that will be given by proprietary ratio. The formula is net worth by total assets. Net worth means shareholder's fund. We call it as shareholder's fund or we call it as net worth, means one and the same. And total assets means fixed asset plus current assets. That's all. Next one is capital gearing ratio. Two ratios we have completed leverage. The first one, debt equity ratio, long term debt divided by shareholders fund. Then second one is proprietary ratio, net worth by total assets. Third, capital gearing ratio. The capital gearing ratio shows the relationship between funds bearing fixed interest and fixed dividend by equity shareholders fund. Funds bearing fixed interest and fixed dividend. So some funds are there on which fixed rate of interest has to be paid. Some funds are there on the fixed rate of dividend has to be paid. Right? So what are the funds on which fixed rate of interest has to be paid? Debentures, bank loan. These are the funds on which fixed rate of interest. And which fund we have to pay fixed rate of dividend? Preference share capital. Preference share capital, we have to pay fixed rate of dividend. The formula will be debentures plus term loan plus preference share capital. So in numerator, we take debentures plus term loans plus preference share capital. And denominator, we take equity shareholders fund. So what do you mean by equity shareholders fund? Equity share capital plus reserves and surplus minus fictitious assets. Equity share capital plus reserves and surplus minus fictitious assets will give you equity shareholders fund. Next ratio is fixed assets ratio. The fixed asset ratio shows the relationship between net fixed assets to capital employed. That means, what is the percentage of fixed assets which are coming from capital employed? What do you mean by capital employed? First of all, you must know, capital employed means shareholders fund plus long-term liabilities. Capital employed is equal to shareholders fund plus long-term liability. In other words, I can say equity share capital plus preference share capital plus reserves and surplus plus long-term debts minus fictitious assets. Long-term debts includes debentures and bank loan. Debentures and bank loan. So if you include debentures and bank loan in shareholders fund, then you will get capital employed. So capital employed is equal to shareholders fund plus debentures and bank loan. So capital employed will take it in denominator. Numerator, fixed assets. So normally it's a prudent policy that fixed assets should be purchased from capital employed only. The fixed assets should be purchased from long-term funds only. No fixed asset should be purchased from short-term funds. So always this fixed asset ratio should be less than 1. Less than 1 or maximum equal to 1. The fixed asset ratio should never be more than 1. If it is more than 1, it means fixed assets are purchased from short-term funds. Fixed assets are purchased from short-term funds if it is more than 1. So always every business should try to maintain the fixed asset ratio at 1 or less than 1. All the fixed assets should be purchased from capital employed. Next one is interest coverage ratio. The interest coverage ratio shows how many times the interest, fixed interest charges is of PBIT. PBIT stands for profit before interest and tax. Profit before interest and tax, that is PBIT. So how many times our PBIT is of interest? Of interest. Simple example I'll give you. Suppose a company is having 10,000 rupees fixed interest charges per annum for 1 year. 10,000 rupees fixed interest charges, and the PBIT of the business is 1 lakh. The profit before interest and taxes is 1 lakh. So 1 lakh divided by 10,000. 1 lakh divided by 10,000, you'll get 10 times. You'll get 10 times. So interest coverage ratio is 10 times. What does it mean? Our PBIT is 10 times of interest. Our profit before interest and tax is 10 times of our interest charges. So a higher interest coverage ratio is better for the business. A higher interest coverage ratio is better for the business. It is taking more number of times than the interest charges. Then next one is dividend coverage ratio. How many times our PAT, profit after tax, how many times our PAT is of fixed preference dividend. Fixed preference dividend. The formula is PAT divided by fixed preference dividend. Example, a business organization is having a PAT, profit after tax, of 1 lakh rupees. 1 lakh rupees is a PAT. Now, annual fixed preference dividend is 10,000. Annual fixed dividend is 10,000. Preference dividend is 10,000. So, how many times our PAT is 1 lakh rupees divided by 10,000? So, 10 times. So, we can say dividend coverage ratio is 10 times. That means our PAT is 10 times of our fixed preference dividend. That's it. So, how many formulas I have given? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, totally 6 formulas I have explained on leverage or capital structure. First 4 formulas I have explained on liquidity. So, 4 plus 6, 10. So, 10 formulas I have explained you. Briefly, we'll recap and then round up this session. So, liquidity ratio. The ability of the business to pay the current obligation on time is called liquidity. For liquidity, current ratio, current assets by current liabilities. Quick ratio, quick asset by current liabilities. Absolute liquid ratio, absolute liquid assets by current liabilities. Basic defensive interval ratio, that is quick assets divided by projected daily cash requirement. And projected daily cash requirement is equal to projected cash operating expenses divided by number of working days in a year. That's all. These 4 formulas are liquidity formulas. Now, leverage or capital structure, 6 formulas. First, debt equity ratio. Long term debt divided by shareholders fund. Long term debt means debentures, bank loan or other long term loans. And shareholders fund means equity share capital plus preferential capital plus reserves and surplus minus fictitious assets. Second one is proprietary ratio. Net worth by total assets. Net worth means shareholders fund. And total assets is equal to current assets plus fixed assets. Next comes capital gearing ratio. Capital gearing ratio. So debentures plus bank loan plus any other preferential capital. Debentures plus term loans plus preferential capital divided by equity shareholders fund. Next one is fixed assets ratio. Fixed assets divided by capital employed. And capital employed is equal to shareholders fund plus long-term debts. Shareholders fund plus long-term debt. In other words, equity share capital plus preferential capital plus reserves and surplus plus debentures and bank loan minus fictitious asset. Then interest coverage ratio. How many times our PBIT is of interest charges? So PBIT divided by fixed interest charges. Then dividend coverage ratio. How many times our PAT, profit after tax, is of fixed preference dividend? So PAT divided by fixed preference dividend. That's all. So I have explained you 2 topics, liquidity and leverage. Next video, inshallah, I will start the next 2, classification of ratios, that is activity turnover ratios and profitability ratios. So keep watching. Don't miss this theory part. It's very, very important. If you concentrate now, you will enjoy learning the problems. Otherwise, every problem will be difficult.